Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee in 2022. Our first item of business today is a decision to take item 4 in private. I'm just looking around my virtual room just to make sure that colleagues are all agreed. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much indeed. The committee will now take evidence on the Scottish Child Payment Regulations 2020 and the Disability Assistance for Children and Young People Scotland Regulations 2021, Miscellaneous Amendments, Regulations 2022. I welcome to the meeting Ben McPherson, MSP, Minister for Social Security and Local Government, Neil Wilson, Disability Benefits Policy Manager, and Kirsten Simonet-Lefevre, Principal Legal Officer at the Scottish Government as well. I'd now like to invite the Minister to please make an opening statement. Mr McPherson, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, members. A happy new year to you all, as this is the first committee session I've attended of you and Ms. Dawn. Convener, members, colleagues, I'm grateful for the opportunity to meet with the committee to discuss these regulations, which reflect our continuing commitment to make improvements and to listen closely to stakeholders, provide a system that meets people's needs. The committee is aware of the Scottish Government's strong commitment to promoting benefit take-up. The regulations before us today are important in the rare occasions that suspending assistance is beneficial for the individual involved and/or the integrity of Scotland's social security system. The Scottish Government is seeking to introduce the power to suspend assistance in a narrow set of circumstances where it is vital to protect people who rely on our payments. Furthermore, it is also vital to ensure an efficient social security system for Scotland. The power to suspend assistance in a narrow set of circumstances will help to avoid unnecessary overpayments and to protect vulnerable individuals from risk of abuse. Putting these measures in place is also part of being a responsible government. Convener, for clarity, these regulations before us today apply only to child disability payment and Scottish child payment. We are seeking to introduce powers to suspend adult disability payment in a narrow set of circumstances as part of the main regulations for that form of assistance, which of course we'll be discussing next week. It is important to recognise that we are not seeking or planning to take the same approach as the DWP suspensions. Let me be very clear, the effect of these regulations before us is not intended to be punitive or make clients worse off. We have consistently chosen to limit when we can suspend assistance. The regulations enable us to suspend payments if an individual fails to provide us with information we need to decide if they should get child disability payment or Scottish child payment within a reasonable and appropriate time period. In accordance with Social Security guidance, individuals will have a minimum 28 days to provide information. Moreover, when we request information, we will encourage individuals to ask for more time to provide the information if they need it. Stakeholders like the Child Poverty Action Group, Citizens Advice Scotland, and Inclusion Scotland told us of the importance of suspending payments in the circumstances covered in these regulations, because some vulnerable individuals may not take action until they see that their payments. However, suspending payment rather than ending assistance ensures, of course, that individuals have a better opportunity to engage with Social Security Scotland rather than immediately losing their entitlement. The regulations also allow for suspension of payments where ministers pay assistance to a third party. This could be to protect someone from the risk of financial abuse or the third party of being unable to continue receiving payments. For child disability payment, payment may also be suspended where a third party is receiving payment but is not engaging with Social Security Scotland when the child turns 16 and becomes responsible for managing their own entitlement. These regulations also introduce a number of key safeguards. This includes the right to request the review of the decision to suspend, and our case managers must also consider the individual's financial circumstances before deciding to suspend. This is essential to avoiding unnecessary hardship. As well as the provisions on suspension of assistance, we've taken the opportunity in these regulations to also make minor miscellaneous amendments to the Child Disability Payment and the Scottish Child Payment Regulations in order to give full effect to the original policy intent. Kavir and I welcome the opportunity to assist the committee with its consideration of the regulations, and I look forward to any questions members may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister, for that helpful introduction. I'll now move to questions from colleagues. First, I have Marie McNair, followed by Miles Briggs, please. Marie McNair, please.
Thank you. Good morning, Convener, and good morning, Minister. The introduction of the suspension option is a welcome move away from the DWP position, as you already said, that can often see benefit entitlement completely stopped and a new claim required. Universal Credit is notorious for this. How confident are you that claimants, particularly those who are vulnerable, will adequately assist to respond to the need for further information?
Minister.
Thank you to Marie McNair for that question. And of course, this is an issue we have considered significantly in the process of the development of these regulations and in response to the SCOS recommendations. The member will be aware that in our response to SCOS, we extended the position so that we were committing to a minimum of 28 days for people to respond to requests for information. And I stress the point that that is a minimum because we, as I stated in the opening statement, will also encourage individuals to ask for more time if that is required. And Social Security Scotland will extend this period where it is reasonable to do so, having regard to the individual's circumstances. We will also withdraw requests for information if they no longer appear reasonable. For example, because the individual tells Social Security Scotland that they do not have the requested information, and we will explain clearly to individuals what information is being requested and why. And as I said, individuals will be encouraged to contact Social Security Scotland if they think they will have trouble providing the requested information within the requested time, and importantly as well, if a suspension would likely cause hardship.
Thank you. Marie McNair.
Thank you, Minister. What efforts will be made by Social Security Scotland to make support networks aware of the suspension provision and what to look out for when supporting people to respond?
Minister.
So we're of course engaged with the relevant stakeholders on this matter, and that will be an ongoing point of consideration, and guidance will be made public. Of course, and of course, the advocacy service that we are providing will be there to support people, and part of that support will include making sure that people are aware of the circumstances around how long they have to respond, and that they are encouraged to contact Social Security Scotland if they are having any difficulties in that regard.
Thank you, Minister. Assuming that's the conclusion of Marie McNair's questions, I bring in Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to the panel as well. Thank you for joining us this morning. I wanted to ask what the government's plans are with a regard to overpayment, which would potentially build up as a result of continuing to pay some of the benefits, and specifically a question around the advantages and disadvantages around self-assessment.
Minister.
Thanks, Mr. Briggs. So this is a really important area, and also important with regard to why we are introducing these regulations, and that we want to avoid overpayments as much as possible and make sure that there's that engagement with individuals. And part of these regulations, of course, is encouraging that contact and that engagement to avoid overpayments building up. With regard to self-assessment compared with an objective test, and of course, there's a point of consideration with SCOS, and also a number of years ago during the passage of the Social Security Administration Tribunal membership, Scotland Bill, Now Act. And in that period, as members will be aware, almost all stakeholders expressed a view that there must be consideration of hardship when a decision is made to suspend assistance, and we have of course agreed with that. But if the individual self-assesses that suspending payment of assistance would place them in hardship, there's a strong ambition from stakeholders, rightly in my view, in our view, that ministers will not suspend assistance when requested information is not provided. So all of that considered, the benefit of the self-assessment approach is that suspension decisions will be both straightforward for Social Security Scotland to process, but also should result in very few requests for a review of the decision to suspend. We are not convinced that an approach of Social Security Scotland to objectively assess hardship would be proportionate, given the added complexity that it would introduce, because assessing hardship would take longer, and that delay, feeding into Mr. Briggs's important question, could lead to more overpayments during in some cases. Also, as I said, the objective test would be more onerous on the individual and would be less satisfactory for them as clients, the objective test compared to the self-assessment approach would be more administratively complex for Social Security Scotland as well. So all of this considered, we believe that objectively assessing hardship would cause delay, which would lead to overpayments during, and therefore the self-assessment approach is the best position to take with regard to these matters.
Miles Briggs.
Thank you for that. Yes, please. Two other points, two questions I wanted to put. If someone, therefore, Minister, fails to engage with a review of their disability benefit, at what point then in this new system that you provide information result in a benefit potentially being stopped?
Minister.
So, of course, there are a number of variables here as to, how the individual responds to the request for information, and then if they respond within the 28 days stating that they are that would place them in hardship, or that they're not able to provide the information, and that of course would process, that would initiate a further process of engagement with the individual on their circumstances. Just to be clear, suspension will be used as a last resort by Social Security Scotland, and that will be where an individual has failed to engage over a minimum of a 28-day period. And of course, when assistance is suspended, Social Security Scotland will issue the individual with a notice explaining that their entitlement to assistance may be ended if the requested information is not provided within 28 days of the notice. And ending an individual's benefit will, as I said, be a last resort and will only be done if all alternative means of obtaining the information have been exhausted and requested information is needed to accurately determine entitlement.
Miles Briggs, before I bring in Natalie Dawn.
Thank you. And finally, I just wondered if the Minister could update the committee with regards to workforce. We've been discussing this at length as a committee and actually on a visit with Social Security Scotland. So I just wondered, in terms of those professionals who will be tasked with undertaking this work, where recruitment's at and what discussions specifically have taken place, and I've raised this with the Minister before, with general practice in terms of the provision of information from them and the payments and expectation for them to help provide that.
Minister.
Again, two important questions from Mr. Briggs, which I will touch on briefly just now, but I think it might be helpful for me to get a response from the agency for Mr. Briggs as a current position. But I can say that from my very recent call with senior members of staff in the agency, which of course I have on a regular basis, recruitment is going very well, and we're very pleased about the progress of that. And part of that recruitment is, of course, health and social care staff, and that recruitment is also been progressing in a successful manner, successful position, and also that the wider engagement with health boards is in a very positive place. But I will elaborate on that further and provide the committee with an update over and above what I've just said in writing, if that would be helpful for Mr. Briggs and the committee more widely.
It would, Minister, in particular on the point around the compensation or the arrangements that may be in place for medical professionals providing supporting information for people's claims. I think that would be really helpful. It was a point of interest when we met with Social Security Scotland, and I think that was at the thrust of Mr. Briggs's question, so that would be incredibly helpful, please. I now bring in Natalie Dawn, please.
Thanks. Morning, everyone. Morning, Minister. So I just want to ask if we do get to the point where an applicant's payment is suspended, so I believe they legally have to complete the review within 31 days. Now, this seems an extremely long period of time for someone to go without their income when they might be entitled to it. So can I just clarify if they give the information earlier within that time period, would that start the process of getting their payments back, or would they have to wait for the 31 days? And if that is the case, would it be possible to shorten that time?
Minister.
So I'll bring Neil in a moment, but the intention is to obtain the information as quickly as possible from the individual in order to assist them. And of course, the individual circumstances will be considered by those who are making judgments in the agency on these matters. But Neil, can you just give that clarity, please?
Thanks, Minister. So when the information is requested, because the purpose of requesting it is that it's material to carrying out our review, then we would want to carry out the review, and then once we've made the determination of entitlement, the suspension must be ended.
Okay.
Natalie,
go
on. Do you have
one further question? It's sort of already been raised, but it's just in regard in relation to the guidance around this, around the suspension and the ending of benefits. So can I just ask when that information is going to be publicly available, and can I ask if this guidance will be in a sort of easy read format so that everyone can understand it? So basically, as long as it's not full of jargon and we've got it in a kind of user friendly format, otherwise I think it could just lead to more uncertainty. And I'm just asking if the Minister would consider ensuring that this guidance, which is available to the public, will be in an easily readable format, that it's clear and, as far as reasonably practicable, is easy to understand.
Minister.
Yeah, I fully empathise with that and think they're really important points. So we have a wider commitment to external communications being both inclusive and easy to understand and consider for those who are accessing the service and the public more widely. So yes, it will be in that style and form so that people can easily understand it. The detailed decision-making guidance has been prepared, but it's currently being quality reviewed and going through the various processes to make sure it's absolutely as it needs to be. It will, as I said, get published publicly once it is finalised. And I think in order to be as expedient as possible to keep the committee up to speed, I'd be happy to commit convener to for officials to update the committee as soon as a publication date is set, and then to be forthcoming in providing an appropriate copy and link to where it will be found in the public domain.
Thank you, Minister. I believe that covers Natalie Dawn's question, so I'd like to bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy next, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to all the other panel. Thank you for joining us today. I have a few questions around the area of suspension. The first question I have is slightly less to do with the specifics of that and more about the time that SCOS has available to it to do the scrutiny. So you'll be aware that, again, SCOS has raised concern about the timescales in the regs. Is it, can the Minister briefly, before I move on to my other questions, update the committee on current plans for additional resources for SCOS?
Minister.
So, since I last updated the committee on this, work is ongoing, both in terms of continued engagement with SCOS, and of course, just can't put it on the record enough how grateful we are for the work that SCOS does and the input that it puts into our collective determination to build a social security system here in Scotland that is as effective and as possible and is shaped in the way that it should be in order to serve those who we wish to assist. As I've discussed before with the committee, there are commitments that the government have made and will be fulfilling around helping SCOS with extra secretariat resource and in order to help them in terms of the practical support in order to undertake their important work. One of the challenges of 2021, of course, was the pressure on SCOS because of the number of regulations that it had to consider, not just within the programme, but additional regulations that emerged just through circumstance and events. For example, the regulations around those settling here in Afghanistan, from Afghanistan. There is an ambition to make sure that SCOS has both adequate resource and time to assess regulations. But of course, we are also, as well as our programming, subject to the process of events. I can update the committee today to confirm and reassure that resource that is coming forward to support SCOS is in process. I'd be happy to as part of the formal follow-up that I've already committed to provide a little more information on that, if that would be helpful for Ms. Pam Duncan Glancy and also for committee more widely.
Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for that answer, Minister. And I would very much appreciate the follow-up information, including what that resource will be, when it's expected to be in place, and how much more additional either staff or time will be bought by that resource. So that'd be excellent if the Minister was able to do that sooner rather than later. Thank you. I very much, as others have said, welcome the provisions in the regs to suspend payment and that they will not be punitive. And I think that approach is significantly better for people across Scotland than what has gone before it, and there is no doubt about it. And so I really welcome that. And I think it will be much more beneficial. A couple of questions specifically on it. I also think the longer time for people to provide information, and my colleague Natalie Dawn spoke of this a moment ago, the longer time available for people to provide information is welcome, and the 28 days. However, CPAG did say in their evidence last week or the week before, I'm losing track of time, that actually that people would probably need sometimes, in some cases, 8 weeks. Now, notwithstanding the impact that would have on their finances, as highlighted by my colleague Natalie Dawn, what has the government considered? What has the government taken into consideration with the timescale that you're asking people to provide information? And how did it come to the conclusion that 28 days was the number to choose, as opposed to 8 weeks as suggested by CPAG?
Minister.
Thanks. I'm going to bring Neil in a moment again, but I would just firstly state that and re-emphasise what I've laid out from the opening statement onwards this morning, is that 28 days is a minimum, and it will be important for those who are engaging with cases to take into consideration an individual's circumstances. For example, if the individual says that they don't have the information or that they can't provide it within that time period, that will be taken in good faith in order to make sure that adequate time is therefore applied in order for the individual to provide the information that's required and for other considerations to be undertaken in order to help the individual acquire what the agency needs in order to make the decision. I'll bring Neil in now to touch on that further, because he has of course considered that throughout the process of this and since the passing of the 2018 Act. Neil.
Thank you, Minister. Yes, it's in the client's interest and the agency's interest to have the determination resolved as soon as possible, but also we need to build in a reasonable amount of time for the individual to provide the information. And I think 4 weeks was seen as a reasonable amount as a kind of a minimum period that would allow the individual to seek advice from independent advice if required. But yeah, as the Minister has said, it's a minimum period and we absolutely would take individual circumstances into account.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you for that. That's really helpful. And the point on it being a minimum period is really useful, and I know that people will appreciate that. And so thank you for setting that out. And the final question I have is around advocacy provision and the fact that there is no advocacy provision at the point of suspension. Judith Robertson from the SHRC said in her evidence that people with mental ill health might find it difficult to engage in the suspension process or during the review of a person's entitlement. So can the government set out what it will do specifically to ensure that the system of suspension doesn't negatively impact on some groups? And also, can you set out your thinking around advocacy and why a legal right to advocacy does not extend to suspension?
Minister.
So I want to reassure the committee that advocacy will be available to all clients who self-certify as having a disability, including individuals applying for or in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment. The advocacy position is strong. Kirsten, do you want to come in and say a bit more about that?
Thank you, Minister. Yes, the right to advocacy is enshrined in the 2018 Act, and it's in connection with the determination of the individual's entitlement to be given assistance, and that means any type of assistance. So it's mainly in connection with making applications where a person might need assistance in that scenario, but it would be in relation to any type of determination they would be able to receive advocacy if that determination was working out how much the assistance they were entitled to be given. So it can be used in a couple of situations, but it's not necessarily used upon the point of when a suspension is considered to be made, because a suspension doesn't actually take entitlement away from the person. It simply stops payments until information is gathered to ensure that they're on the right level of assistance. So it's really in relation to entitlement to assistance being given rather than other parts that happen during the process of being entitled.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you both for your answer. I'm still not 100% clear, forgive me, if someone would be able to access advocacy at that point. And I take the point that advocacy can be about entitlement, but also suspension is very much about entitlement as well, because I understand that the rules on suspension will not be in place if the award is looking to increase. It is only really when it's looking to either stop or continue. So I do feel that advocacy is going to be crucial at that particular point, and we'd urge the government to make it clear that advocacy would be available to people at this point.
Minister.
Kirsten, are you able to just give some clarity from a legal position there, please?
Yes. The right to advocacy continues when a decision is being made on a person's entitlement to assistance. So if it's at the point where a decision is being made that the person is either entitled to more or to less or to no assistance, then advocacy would be available.
Camden Glancy.
Thank you. That's helpful. I have no further questions for this part. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I'd now like to bring in Jeremy Balfour, who I believe has a follow-up to a previous question. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to your team. It's really just to pick up a bit further, and I expect you may want to write to us rather than answer us today. And in regard to the medical reports that we will get from consultants, GPs and other medical professions, and we did have a letter back from Social Security Scotland a few weeks ago, and it was unclear to me whether there was a legal obligation or had there been a contract set up between medical professions if somebody likes to get medical evidence, and also how much that will cost either the individual or the agency, whether there's a set fee. My experience previously has been that sometimes it's very difficult to get medical evidence because of the pressure medical professions are under. So I wonder if you could just give us a wee bit more information either today or in writing in regard to, is there a legal obligation being set up between doctors, nurses, other medical professions to provide that information? And what happens if a GP turns around and says, I won't provide that information for whatever reason?
Minister.
Well, appreciate that that question is relevant here, but is also, of course, relevant to adult disability payment, which I'm discussing next week. So in the interest of time and from that wider perspective, if Sir Balfour is in agreement, I think I would like to take that away and either update the committee on it next week or provide an answer in writing, whatever is preferable to the member or the committee. I mean, I would say, just for reassurance, that of course formal arrangements are in place on all of these matters, but I can elaborate on that either in writing or a future meeting.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful to the Minister for that, and I'd be interested because it wasn't our understanding that there was anything set up between that, so that would be helpful to get more information. Just final question, just in regard to the suspension area. Obviously, if in the end the agency do take away a benefit, there is a right of appeal. That can take a number of weeks, if not months. Can the Minister just reassure me that if the person was successful, that all the payments would be backdated? And is there any mechanism set up to fast-track these type of appeals, but people aren't left in financial crisis?
Minister.
Well, during the period, I'll bring officials in to just clarify this absolutely, but the individual would receive short-term assistance, which of course is innovative and provided here in Scotland and not in the DWP system. Neil, do you want to just elaborate on that briefly?
Thanks, Minister. Yes. So they wouldn't receive a backdated amount, but exactly because, as you say, they would have been providing, they would have been receiving short-term assistance throughout the period of review, so they would be no worse off.
And just on Mr. Balfour's last question, just for clarity, Convener, just I stated that the arrangements are in place. The nature of the arrangements between the agency and practitioners and health boards, I will set out. I didn't want to. Mr. Balfour talked about a formal position, and I just want to make sure that I'm clear that I will elaborate on the wider circumstances of that engagement with practitioners and health boards as a follow-up.
Thank you, Minister. Before I bring in Emma Roddick, is there any further question from you, Mr. Balfour?
No, thank you. Convener, that's me done.
Thank you. Emma Roddick, please.
Thank you. Good morning, convener. I won't be the only person who's already getting casework from people with active DLA claims who are confused about whether they should be applying for CDP and hoping to end their DLA claim as soon as possible. So how does the minister plan to communicate the potential dangers around stopping a current claim to move to CDP faster to current DLA claimants? And does he have any guidance on how long people can expect to wait to be moved across?
Minister.
So with CDP, of course, we're undertaking case transfer as quickly as we can. When we launched child disability payment and similarly as we move towards launching adult disability payment, of course, our strong advice is for people to wait until they're transferred, because that will be a better experience for them in terms of it will be done seamlessly, and Social Security Scotland will manage the process. So we are very keen to stress to people that they should wait until case transfer is undertaken. In terms of if individuals are choosing to end a DLA or PIP award in order to claim CDP or ADP, that's always an individual's choice. But our concern is that in doing so, they are exposing themselves to risk that a carefully managed case transfer programme avoids. For example, if someone bypasses the case transfer process, they will be required to make a new application and provide information and evidence on their care and mobility again, which may cause undue stress or anxiety. And of course, there's no guarantee that the person will be awarded CDP or ADP, although it would be, of course, more likely than not, be paid at the same rate. There's no guarantee of that either, to the same account at the same time. So for all of those reasons, we think it's much better if people wait until our case transfer process takes place in order to make sure that they have the best experience when moving from the DWP to Social Security Scotland. So I'm grateful for all of those who in third sector, parliamentarians, other stakeholders who are helping to emphasise the point to people that it's much better for them if they let us manage the process of transferring their entitlement to Social Security Scotland, and that will be done in a seamless manner.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Minister for all the detail in the response there. Can I also ask what criteria are being used to prioritise moves from DLA to CDP? Is there anything that people can do to speed up that process themselves?
Minister.
So I'd be grateful if Emma could elaborate slightly on that point, just so I'm absolutely clear.
Emma Roddick.
Yeah, which DLA claimants are being moved first?
Within the case transfer process to child disability payment. Well, there's a detailed process of engagement between DWP and Social Security Scotland on which batches of cases are being done. It's being done in a way that is in order to make sure that we do it in a way that is coherent and professional in terms of a prioritisation based on need or any considerations around that. That's not a relevant factor in the regard. The position is that it's being done in a practical way and in a systematic way in order to transfer those on disability living allowance for children to child disability payment in order to meet our completion aspiration of spring 2023 for that particular Scottish benefit.
Marodic.
That's me. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Pam Duncan Glancy next, please.
Thank you, Convener. And it's actually an extension of my colleague Emma Roddick's questions around the process for people applying. And one of the things that we heard last month, I think, from Enable Scotland was that there was about 141,000 people in Scotland who are still on PIP or who enter the PIP system who would otherwise have been eligible for ADP or child disability payment as well will be higher than that number. 55,000 of them will possibly have a mental ill health problem, which would mean they would have a bit more difficulty in I would say, than the PIP system, face-to-face system, than they would potentially in the child disability payment or adult disability payment. So I can fully understand why people might want to stop their existing claim and try and get onto a system that we're promoting in Scotland that should be kinder in that respect. One of the questions they asked us was whether or not the government would actually commit to the rapid transfer of people from child disability payment and adult disability payment to child disability payment and adult disability payment from PIP who successfully made a claim during the delay period of the previous year when the full rollout was delayed as a result of the coronavirus. Is that something that the government would consider? And it's my view that that might help mitigate some of the concerns that you've actually highlighted really well in terms of the risks of stopping a current award in order to claim child disability payment or adult disability payment. So would you consider the prioritising them, particularly since the government also said that no one would have to go through a review process once the rollout started, that they would be reviewed by ADP or CDP, not PIP?
Minister.
Thanks, Convener, and thanks to Pam Duncan-Clancy for those questions. If it's agreeable to yourself and the committee, if it's appropriate also for me to state that I think that is a question that's, again, broader than the set of regulations before us today, and that is particularly relevant to considerations around adult disability payment regulations that we are considering next week. I'd be happy to touch on this matter next week with regard to case transfer when we consider the adult disability payment regulations, but also if it would be helpful for the committee at a future juncture beyond the 27th of January to perhaps come to the committee another time to discuss case transfer as a topic in general and beyond consideration of specific regulations, because the process and the assistance that I will have next week in terms of official representation will be better placed to touch on these matters.
Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for your answer, Minister. I take the point that the adult disability payment regulations will be coming next week. I raised it on the basis that to try and prevent the preemptive stopping of someone's claim and making a new claim within the Scottish system, if we could reassure people, as well as promoting it in the way that my colleague Emma Roddick pointed out, but if we could also reassure people that there will be a system of prioritisation for those people who would have otherwise have guaranteed the review. That's why I asked it today in relation to those regulations. And my final question on this is, how long do you expect, or does the Minister, expect to take for the case transfer to take place?
Minister.
So, as I alluded to in my answer to Emma Roddick, there's no, as far as I'm aware, prioritisation within the case transfer process with regard to circumstance or condition. But there are, of course, considerations with regard to case transfer around, for example, natural case transfer. If people who are approaching a review date on their DWP award, for example. And that's why I suggested that it might be helpful for the committee to discuss case transfer in the round at a future juncture. But I should be clear that there, as far as I'm aware, there is no prioritisation in the way that Pam Duncan-Glancy alluded to within the case transfer process as things stand. And as has been stated to Parliament on several occasions,
We intend to have all case transfer completed in 2025. That is the position of regards. As well as the transfer from disability living allowance for children to child disability payment, we are working to complete by spring 2023.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener. I have no further questions.
Thank you very much. Just before I want to just double check to make sure that there are no further questions from any colleagues, I just wanted to seek some further clarity, Minister, on the point around right to advocacy, if that's possible, please. Because SCOS had said in their evidence that, that they believed that there was not a right. However, I take what has been said by Kirsten in answer to previous questions. So I just wanted to, perhaps it's something to follow up in writing, but just to get some absolute clarity there as to my reading of what has been said there, which is that if there is a question or a dubiety over entitlement, that somebody has a right to advocacy, but I just wondered if that would be possible to be confirmed, please.
Yeah, we can confirm that today, Convener, and I'll just bring Kirsten in to further clarify to provide the SGLD position on the clarity as well. But in any circumstance where the individual's entitlement is being questioned, they of course will be entitled to advocacy and will be able, as it will be available to all clients across Scotland who certify to having a disability. So the position is clear that I think the point of dubiety from the committee this morning has been in that window, that period of suspension, and as Kirsten has said, the advocacy is not there is not a position of requirement for advocacy at that juncture. It's only if it progresses to the position of their entitlement being questioned, then of course the right to advocacy will kick in. Kirsten, do you want to add anything further on that?
Yes, thank you, Minister. I think we have some policy confirmation that the National Advocacy Service is that advocacy will be provided to assist individuals in connection with a suspension decision if they self-certify as having a disability. So it goes above and beyond the exact point when a determination in relation to entitlement is being decided. So, although Section 10 says it's in connection with a determination of entitlement, the advocacy service seems to be providing services at that point also. But what we could do is write to the committee and confirm the exact points that when advocacy is available to people, and we can add that to the letter.
Thank you very much. Yeah, that would be very helpful. And I think the points that Minister and yourself have just made there have provided clarity there, but anything that you can follow up in writing in terms of the points and junctures, that would be most helpful, and I thank you for that. I believe that takes us to the conclusion of colleagues' questions, and unless anybody else is looking to come in at this stage, we will move on to agenda item 3, which is the formal debate on the motion. I remind the committee that only members and the minister may take part in the formal debate. So I invite the minister now to move the motion S6M02786 that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Scottish Child Payment Regulations 2020 and the Disability Assistance for Children and Young People Scotland Regulations 2021 Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2022 draft be approved.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you, Minister. Do any members wish to speak in the debate on the motion? Please type R in the chat box at this stage If you would wish to come in at this point, allowing for some expansion to allow colleagues time, if that is what they wish. I don't believe anybody does wish to come in which case the question is that motion S6M02786 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. That's very helpful. Thank you very much indeed. The motion is therefore approved. I invite the committee to agree that the clerks and I will produce a short factual report of the committee's decisions and arrange to have it published. Is that content, colleagues content for that approach to take place as previous? Thank you very much. Thank you very much indeed to the Minister and to Neil and Kirsten for coming along this morning as well. Your evidence has been very helpful to us and we've greatly appreciate your time as always. Thank you very much indeed. I hope you all have a lovely day. That concludes the public